Let me introduce you to an example application that we created to show how to use some of the OT2 services. This example application is available as a tutorial on developer.opentext.com, and we also published a project in GitHub for you to explore and to see how we call the different services in OT2. So this project has a backend written in Node.js and a frontend written in React. If you clone or download it, you can use the run command to start it up. It will load some additional libraries, then comes up with the login UI. But before you can use the login UI, you need to configure the application first with a couple of things. You need to create an application in your development tenant. So create a new application and download the config file. This configuration file contains the client ID and client secret. This we will configure in the config UI together with the tenant ID. This tenant ID can be found here in the developer console. You can copy and paste it. Once you've provided all this information, you can log in to the application with the credentials that you have. Here we see the contract approval demo app as it is. So it allows a user to upload a contract, give the contract a name and a contract value, and specify a requester email. This requester email will be used to send an email of the approval that is done in the end. So once the contract is added to the application, you can request approval. After that, it's a task is created for the manager to look at the contract and decide whether or not to approve. This application uses a couple of OT2 services. The first is the contract storage service, which is used to store the actual documents. So the documents are stored in the content storage service, or CSS for short. The content metadata, so the document name, contract value, and the email, and some other properties, these are stored in the content metadata service, CMS in short. Then there's a workflow tying this all together and determining whether or not the document needs to be approved by a manager. So if the value is above 1,000, then the manager needs to approve, otherwise we can automatically approve. And in this release, we added integration with Magellan Risk Guard. So that's new in this version. We also sent the document to Magellan Risk Guard. Risk Guard will have a look at the document and extract the personal identifiable information from it, which we then use in the application to specify a risk classification level to the document. The workflow will also request an approval if the risk classification is high or very high, as we will see once in action. So here we upload document contract 4, which has a value of 900, but a risk classification of high. So this means that this document needs to be approved by the manager. So the manager will look at the document and decide whether or not to approve it or not. So we've seen that the Risk Guard service extracted several things, PII related data. Yeah, and so if you now, so the manager now approves the contract, and also this contract is shown here in the All Contracts tab, which shows all contracts that have been processed so far. So let's add one more document, contract number 5. This document contains quite a lot of personal identifiable information. We also give it a high value, above 1,000 at least. So we are sure the manager will receive a task for this to look at the document. And if we now request approval, we go to the second tab to see the manager task that is created by the workflow. Risk classification here is considered as a high, as we have a social security number, credit card number, lots of personal names, phone numbers, all these things. And if we also have a look at the actual document, we indeed see that the information is there. So this all is extracted by the Magellan Risk Guard service. So you just send up the document and it returns a set of categories and data that it found for this for these categories. And that is what we use now also in this application. So we, the admin rejected this specific contract because its risk classification is too high. As a last thing, the workflow will send out an email to the requester. So we had some approved, and the last one, which last contract is rejected, as we see here. So you get a mail, which is sent from the workflow. So that was the demo of the app itself. So now let's see how we've built it and what services we use. So here, so in the GitHub project, we also provide a Postman collection, which helps you to even more understand the different requests we do. So how to get an access token, how to create a namespace, in this case, OT2 underscore approval. Here we see the attributes of the CMS type definition. So the contract's value, the status, the email, and also the risk card classification will be stored in this. And so there's also a call to put in the model, the workflow model definition, which then can be executed. To retrieve a single file, you can call the CMS service with the actual file ID. So that will return the different properties of this one file to get all the CMS entities, I need to say. That's what we see here. So we see contract 4 and the other properties of the metadata, including the risk card. So here we see a call to risk card where we uploaded the contract 5 PDF and the actual response is given. It returns the PII data, including the social security numbers, whatever it's found. So switching back to the developer console. In developer console, you can also see the actual calls that you did for this specific application. It shows you the top four calls on the right side, and per endpoint, you can also see the calls that are done. In the developer console, we can also open the workflow modeler. Again, in the GitHub project, we provide you the workflow that we are using for the application. That is what we see here. So this is the actual workflow that is used by the contract approval demo app. For example, the first step here is to get the contract from CMS, which is a get to the CMS endpoint where we specify the contract ID. And in the response, the JSON body is returned and is processed here in the different if statements. So if the contract is above 1,000, then we request approval. Otherwise, we check the risk classification level. If it is high or very high, then we also request an approval. So you can update the status of the CMS data also via some calls. If you want to have more detail on the actual APIs, then you can go into the Swagger documentation as we see here. So how to create a specific CMS instance. You send a post with the different attributes and the value. Also to store, to upload the file and to the content storage service, you will do a multi-part form post by sending the document to this service. It will be linked to the content metadata service, and so you can use it for later. This demo application is described in great detail and explained in great detail in developer opentext.com in one of the tutorials, as you see here. So we give a detailed explanation of the different requests that we do from within the application. We help you set up your local development environment by installing Node, some other things. We explain the Postman collection that is part of the GitHub project. And here, like I mentioned, we explain the different calls that are done to CMS, to CSS, to the other services, and also explain how to use the application and what we are doing from the front-end UI. Also the workflow is explained so that you understand what happens with the different steps. So if you even want to have more information about the content metadata service or the other services, it's all there on developer.opentext.com. OpenText also provides you with a free 90-day trial. And with this, you can start developing your own applications. And I would say, give it a try.